All right, so this is part two of the lectures for week two. And in this particular video, we're going to do several things. I'm going to talk a bit about the what's called the ecliptic, which is the motion that the Earth takes about the sun. And that's how we sort of locate where planets are and the sun and the moon. And we'll talk a little bit about history as well. And then this is all going to lead into discussing how over time we've developed the model of the solar system that we understand today. Okay, now I'm going to start by talking about this thing called the ecliptic here. Now, the ecliptic is part of the celestial sphere. However, I'm not going to quite connect it to the celestial sphere. I'm going to wait a bit to do that because it can be a little complicated to understand how the ecliptic is connected to the celestial sphere. And so it's kind of helpful to sort of understand a lot about it first before we actually get into those details. There's a lot of different ways to describe what the ecliptic is. The ecliptic is simply the plane of the solar system, which is defined by the orbit of the Earth. So that's one way you can talk about it. The ecliptic is a line that represents the orbit of the Earth. From the perspective of Earth, however, you can describe this as the path that the sun takes through what we call the zodiacal constellations over the course of a year. So this is the apparent motion of the sun, but that's due to Earth's orbit about the sun. You can also simply say that it's a line in the sky, and it's the projection of Earth's orbit into the sky. Any way you describe it, but simply it's relative to Earth's orbit. Now, that being said, I want to make sure we get really clear some terminology right now. When we talk about Earth's rotation, and that was the subject mostly of the last video, we call that rotation, which is synonymous with spinning. And you want to use those terms. Those are synonymous terms, and that's the appropriate way to use those terms. When we describe Earth orbiting the sun, we have a different word for that, and it's revolution. Revolution should be used to describe the translational motion around an object. It should not be used to describe spinning, though. Okay. So rotation and revolution are really different things. You don't want to describe how the Earth goes about the sun by saying the Earth rotates. I know, like in common language, it's that term rotation is kind of very loosely used, but we got to be precise when we describe things here. So it's important that you use the right words for that. So rotation means spinning, and revolution is synonymous with orbit. So that's what we're describing here, revolution and orbit here. Now, I mentioned zodiacal constellations. That is not the same thing as zodiac. Those are different things, and I'll address that in a little bit in this video here. What the zodiacal constellations are, it is a group of 13 constellations, one of which is not being shown in the picture here. And it is a set of constellations that the sun appears to move through as a result of Earth's orbit about the sun. But it's not the same thing as zodiac. Okay, those are different things, actually. You can see in the picture here, there's actually, this figure is really powerful, actually, because it explains a lot of aspects of what can be seen in the sky. So let me give you an example of this. Let's look at March 1st in the picture here. Okay, we see where Earth is located, and we see a direction that we look towards the sun. We would say that the sun is located in the constellation of Aquarius, which means you can't see Aquarius in March because it's up when the sun is up. It's very challenging to even see Pisces or Capricorn because they're very close to where Aquarius is. Now, if you look at the complete opposite side of the sky, there's Leo and Virgo and Cancer. Those things are very easy to see because they're the complete opposite side of the sky with respect to the sun. And so that stuff's up during the nighttime. So it becomes very easy to see those things. And you'll notice as Earth moves along in its orbit, the sun appears to be in different constellations. Those are hard to see during the day, and the ones on the opposite side of the sky are very easy to see at night. When you combine the fact that the Earth rotates and things rise and set, you actually can do something very powerful here. So in this particular picture here, we have some conventions that we like to describe. This view of the solar system is like an overhead view in a way. We're on the same side of the solar system as the Earth's North Pole, and from that perspective, things move counterclockwise. And that is sort of what we call normal motion in the solar system. We also call that prograde motion. We use the word normal because most things move in this way. Every planet orbits the sun prograde. Most planets and objects in the solar system rotate prograde. There are some exceptions, and we'll talk about those later. But counterclockwise and prograde is synonymous. Also, prograde can be associated with a direction, and that would be east. Stars rise in the east, set in the west. That means we are rotating towards the east. And so prograde and east are also synonymous things. So in the picture here, as you move counterclockwise, you're moving in the direction of east. If you go clockwise, that would be west. Let's go back to March, and let's talk a bit about that. March, the sun is in Aquarius. So what that means is when it's sunrise, sun would be coming up, and so would Aquarius. Capricorn, because it is located clockwise or to Aquarius, would be a bit to the west. So it would actually already be up in the sky, visible. You would actually see Capricorn come up first, then you see Aquarius. And everything that is clockwise of Aquarius are all things that could be seen in the early morning. Aquarius comes up, sun is there. If you look towards the west, you'll see Capricorn, then you'll see Sagittarius, then Scorpius, all the way around. And Leo is on the opposite side of the sky. And Leo actually would be setting as Aquarius is coming up. You can do the same thing for when the sun sets. The sun sets in Aquarius, and that means that is in the west. And everything that would be up in the sky is to the east. So that means as the sun sets in Aquarius, the next thing you would see right above the horizon would be Pisces, because that is clockwise and therefore east of it. Then you see Aries, then you see Taurus, all the way around, and then Leo is coming up as the sun is setting. So this figure, like I said, is really powerful, and it really helps you understand what kind of constellations can be seen at different times. You can choose January and do the same thing. The sun is in Sagittarius, so it's very hard to see that, but when the sun rises, it's in Sagittarius. Directly to the west is Scorpius, so that would be up in the morning. Capricorn is to the east. It is counterclockwise. So as Sagittarius sets, Capricorn is right there in the sky. So this figure can help you identify those things pretty easily. All right, so I got a question for you. If you follow everything I said there, we're trying to figure out what zodiacal constellations would arise just before sunrise on March 1st. So think about that for a moment. Okay, the answer here is Capricorn. Okay, so to explain that again, just before sunrise. If the sun rises in the east, then the constellation that would arise just before it would have to be located to the west of it. Okay, just up in the sky. And then in this picture, west is clockwise. The sun is in Aquarius on March 1st. Just to the west of it is Capricorn. So that's how we identify that. All right, now, how long does this take? Well, the period of revolution, the amount of time it takes to Earth to complete one full orbit about the sun, is 365.24 days. And those days are solar days, right? So 86,400 seconds. And you'll notice that that is not a whole number. And we shouldn't expect it to be a whole number. There's no reason in particular why it should be a whole number. If you think about it, it's a little odd actually that we are using the Earth's rotation mostly to keep track of how long it takes the Earth to orbit, because those two things are not related. The day and the year have no direct relationship to each other. So it's not surprising that when we try to keep track of the year based on the day, that we're going to get a decimal here. It would be an amazing coincidence if the number was a whole number actually. So what is the decimal? Well, the decimal is 2.4, which is very close to 2.5, which is a quarter. So what that means is we have a calendar that's 365 days. And that means in that calendar, we do not keep track of this roughly quarter of a day. So that means when we orbit, there's basically a quarter of a day that's not accounted for in the calendar. And then after 2 years, you have basically a whole half day. A half day that's not accounted for. And then after 4 years, you got almost a complete day not accounted for, which is why we have developed what's called the leap year and the leap day. After 4 years, you have almost a complete day not accounted for. So in order to bring the calendar in sync with the motion of the Earth, we tack on an extra day in February, February 29th, and that helps align the calendar back with the way the Earth is orbiting. Okay, so when people are celebrating midnight on New Year's on New Year's Eve, that's not when the party should begin, because 6 hours after that point, approximately, would be precisely when we were in the exact same spot we were before. But whatever. Anyway, so the... Now, you may want to know why it's February. Why do we stick it in February? Well, February has less days. I mean, that's why. But why does it have less days? And we'll get into this a little bit when we talk about seasons. But it turns out that the wintertime in the Northern Hemisphere is not 90 days. Okay? The seasons are not split equally. It's not 90, 90, 90, 90. Due to the fact that we have an elliptical orbit and we move at different speeds in that orbit, winter is shorter. It's about 88 days. So it naturally has less days in the months. And so it's just convenient to stick the extra day there as opposed to sticking it somewhere else. Summer is about 92 days. And so it would be odd to put it there because already you have more days in summer and now you're at another day. I mean, it doesn't have to be any particular spot. It's just convenient to put it in February because February just got less days in it. All right. Now, what's interesting about there's a couple things I want to say about this. You know, we go with 4 days because of the decimal. But if this is a different decimal, we'd have to do it differently. All right. If it was 0.2, we wouldn't be doing this every 4 years. We'd do it every 5 years. If it was 0.1, we'd do it every 10 years. We're kind of lucky that it's not a weird decimal, because if it was something like, you know, 0.17, that would be harder to do, I guess, or like 0.38 or something. You know, it would be difficult to do. We'd have to create some more elaborate system to keep things in sync. Now, that being said, you'll notice this is not 2.25. It's not 0.25. It's 0.24. And what that means, it's off by about a hundredth of a day. And so what that would mean is if you do this enough, after 100 years, you would be overcompensating by a whole day. So we actually have more complicated rules that we use to do leap day stuff. And the rules go like this. When you look at the year, if it is divisible by 4, then you're supposed to do a leap year. However, if your year is divisible by 100, then you don't do it because of this overcompensation thing here. Now, the decimal actually goes on as more digits than the 2.4, and there is a third rule. And the third rule is if your year is divisible by 400, then you would do it. So the year 2000 was a very odd year because it's divisible by 4 and 100 and 400. So in the year 2000, we were supposed to do the leap year, but then we weren't, but then we did, if you can keep track of that. So anyway, and there's actually were more rules than that, but we don't care. That's far enough in the future. We'll all be dead. Doesn't matter what people in the future figure that out. So if there was another rule, it would be something like every 2,000 years or something, but that's just too long anyway. All right. Now, I just want to make one comment about what I mentioned before about zodiac and zodiacal. The zodiacal constellations is not the same system as the astrologer's zodiac, okay? As you may be aware, astrology and astronomy are different things. Astronomy is a science, and astrology is, well, dependent on your belief system. It's either entertainment or it's, to some people, a religion practically. And you would probably know where I stand on that. You know, this is a science course, and so we're talking about scientific things. You know, in this class, astrology doesn't really have much of an importance. You know, the idea behind it, as far as I am aware, is, you know, the sun is in a particular constellation when you're born, and somehow that dictates your life. That determines your personality and the things that will happen to you. But obviously there's some flaws there. An example would be, you know, twins, right? Identical twins. And what can happen, unfortunately, for an identical twin is one will die and the other one lives on. And how do you explain that in astrology if the sun was in the same place? But But to give you a further comment about that, if you notice here, March 1st says Aquarius. Now, I don't know what your birthday is or if you're familiar with the signs, but generally, if you're born in March 1st, you're not an Aquarius. I'll give you an example. I was born in early January. Early February. I was born in early September. I, Okay. I was born early September, and I'm apparently a Virgo because that's what astrology says. But turns out that if you go to that Stellarium program, you can actually go back and look up where the sun actually was when you were born. And when I do that, it says Leo. And for most people, the constellations are off by one. And the reason why that is because the zodiac is based on a system that existed thousands of years ago and has changed. And the change is due to precession. That change in the axis of the Earth's rotation direction changes that. So likely, whatever sign you are, you're actually not that sign. You're actually the one that's before it. So if you're, whatever. If you like astrology, great, good for you. I don't know. I don't have much more to say about it. Okay, so let's get to the planets here. The ecliptic is really helpful for finding where the planets are located. It's defined as the Earth's, orbit about the sun, which happens to be pretty much the same as all the other planets. The only significant deviation is Mercury. Mercury is tilted by about 7 degrees, which is actually an effect that's due to gravity with the sun. But there's a reason for this, and we'll get into this when we talk about how planets are formed. But, basically the solar system forms at a disk, and the planets condense out of the disk, so they have properties of the disk when they form, so it's not surprising that all the planets look this way. But anyway, when we identify where the ecliptic is in the sky, you can easily identify where all the planets are located. So in one particular case that's very interesting is Venus and Mercury, actually. So, it's always been known that Venus and Mercury have somewhat peculiar positions in the sky. We know today that Mercury and Venus have orbits that are confined within the Earth's orbit. And what that means is when we want to view these things, they are located somewhat near the position of the sun. You cannot see Mercury and Venus, say, in the middle of the night. Okay, the only things you could see in the middle of the night would be planets that could be on the complete opposite side of the sky with respect to the sun. So things like Mars and Jupiter and Saturn, those can be seen in the middle of the night. In fact, what you see in the pictures here show a projection of Mercury and Venus's orbit with respect to the ecliptic. So again, all planets are found near the ecliptic, and you can see the way the orbits look here, how you would see those things. Now, Mercury and Venus are planets that really can only be seen as the sun sets or before the sun rises, and again, because of those confined orbits. So for Mercury in particular, Mercury has an angle of elongation that is 28 degrees. Okay, angle of elongation is the spot on the very edge of the orbit here, and Venus's is one that's up here. That's basically the furthest away that a planet can get from the sun, angle of elongation. Okay. Now, what's helpful about those angles is this. If you take 360 degrees, which is a complete circle, and you divide it by how many hours there are in the day, which is 24, you get 15. What that means is the sky moves about 15 degrees per hour. This 28 degrees is very close to 30, which means about 2 hours of time. When the sun sets, if Mercury is at elongation, then it would be possible to see Mercury up above the horizon for almost 2 hours of time. Okay. Now, given the fact that, the first hour after sunset or before sunrise, the sky is pretty bright, and Mercury is not that bright, actually. So, take the first hour out, there's maybe 1 hour of time. You could possibly see Mercury when the sun sets or before the sun rises, and that's only if it's at elongation. So Mercury is very challenging to see in the sky. And if you don't have a clear horizon, it makes it even harder. Like in the Antelope Valley, when we look to the west, we got a lot of hills and stuff there. So Mercury is really hard to see during sunset. There's flat desert out towards the east, so if you're out in the morning, it's possible to see that a little bit easier. Now, Venus has an angle of elongation of 46 degrees. That's close to 45, and that would be close to 3 hours of time. And that means, again, take that first hour out. We're talking about a good 2 hours of time after sunset and before sunrise, where Venus would be up in the sky. And Venus is very bright, and it's very noticeable. And usually, if you see a very bright star, as the sun sets or before the sun rises in the direction of the sun, you're probably seeing Venus there. And Venus is much more noticeable as a result of that. The other planets, though, they could be anywhere along the ecliptic because they have orbits that are larger than the Earth's orbit. Okay, so that's just one example of how the ecliptic can be helpful for understanding why, like, Mercury and Venus look differently than, say, the outer planets do. Okay, that's sort of why. All right, so now we're going to talk a bit about how humanity has come to understand, the nature of the universe. Okay. And it all starts from trying to observe things in the sky and understand them. Now, when you look at very ancient history, you know, every single civilization has studied the stars to some extent. And typically that's used as a means to keep track of time, to know when weather patterns are going to change, to know when you're going to farm crops, harvest is going to happen, and things like that. So everybody has stories or some means to study the stars. But it's really the Greeks that we attribute to the first civilization to make scientific attempts to understand the cosmos and to predict future behavior. So it's more than just trying to keep track of time. They're trying to figure out why. They're trying to figure out deeper meaning behind what is seen in the sky. And so we're going to start with the Greeks. And the earliest notions of studying the cosmos is around Plato's time. And you can see in the bottom right there the order of objects that the Greeks originally placed in the sky. Moon was first, all the way out to where the stars are. Now, with the naked eye, you can see Moon, Sun, Mercury, Venus, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn. Those seven objects, which has given rise to our 7-day week for the seven objects. Stars were considered to be very distant and far away. The Greek system of understanding the cosmos was very flawed in a lot of ways, as with a lot of other aspects of Greek science. In fact, we describe Greek science as what is now called first principles. First principles is a very bad way to do science, at least from a modern standpoint. The idea behind first principles is you have some preconceived notions about how things work, and you build your ideas behind these preconceived notions, whether they are true or not. We don't like to do that in science. Science today doesn't like to make any assumptions about anything. You just make observations, you come up with ideas for how things work, and you don't want to be limited by having these preconceived notions about how things work. This is kind of the problem we have today with flat Earth. People believe in flat Earth, and then they build their ideas around the assumption that the Earth is flat. And unfortunately, a lot of flat Earth is like that, which is why it's a very, very flawed way of thinking. Okay, and so for the Greeks, the first principles were the following. Earth was believed to be at the center of the universe, and it was motionless and did not move. And, kind of looks that way, so it's not a crazy idea. In fact, it wasn't definitively proven that that was false until Galileo's time, which was about 400 years ago. Furthermore, another assumption was what's called the perfect heavens, in that the motions of objects in the sky were to be described by perfect shapes, spheres, circles, and so on. And that was an assumption made, and it was believed to be true. It's not true. It's close to circles and spheres and things like that, but it's not true. And so that's how they started their astronomy. And there was a lot of really interesting things that happened in Greek astronomy around this time, and I want to go over some of those ideas. I mentioned flat Earth again. One not so prevalent myth today that I still hear occasionally is that, people believe the Earth was flat a long time ago. And that really was not the case. In fact, the Greeks were able to, the Greeks knew the Earth was round. And not only did they knew, but they were able actually to measure what the circumference of the Earth was. And Eratosthenes was a Greek scholar that actually made some interesting observations. And from these observations was able to create an estimate for how big the Earth was. I'm going to put a link in the description to a video from Carl Sagan where he talks a bit about this, but I'll describe it kind of briefly right now. It was known that on the very first day of summer, that when the sun was directly overhead, that shadows appeared different depending on where you were located on the Earth. If you were at this one city in Africa called Cyrene, what would happen is on the first day of summer at noon, there would be no shadows. The sun would be directly overhead and would shine straight down. And if you could look at deep wells, you could look right down to the bottom of the well, as no shadow was being cast in that well. But it was known that at the exact same time, if you were further north in Alexandria, that there were shadows. And that if you had a stake, for example, in the ground, you could actually measure what that shadow was. And the Greeks found that depending on how far north you go at noon on the first day of summer, that there were larger and larger shadows seen. Now, that is the behavior of a curved surface. The farther away you go from where the sun is directly overhead, the more you would see shadows. And so what was done is he had measured the distance between Cyrene and Alexandria. And based on the angle that the shadows make at Alexandria, you can do a real simple angular measurement problem and work out what the radius of the Earth is here. And he was able to work out the circumference of the Earth within sort of like 10 to 15%. And so that was pretty amazing. I mean, so their science is limited in a lot of ways. I mean, their ideas for gravity were things like to be down. And that's how they started talking about gravity. Things prefer to be down, so things fall if they can. That's a weird version of gravity, but that's what they did. But don't want to make it seem like everything was totally naive to Greek science. This particular observation was very, very good and interesting. So, and definitely illustrates the fact that people did not believe a very long time ago that the Earth was flat. Another really interesting contribution in Greek astronomy was made by a Greek astronomer by the name of Hipparchus. Hipparchus created a catalog of stars, which a lot of people did at the time. It was very common to make catalogs of stars to keep track of where stars were located in the sky, to keep track of when certain stars rose and at a particular time of day, particular time of year, and so on. What made Hipparchus a bit different, however, is that in addition to creating a catalog of stars, he also attempted to try to characterize how bright they were. And that system that he developed is a system that we still use today, actually. And it's a qualitative system to use to describe the brightnesses of stars. And it's something that we're going to talk about extensively in this class, magnitude scale. And your book in chapter 2 doesn't discuss this right away. It's discussed a bit later on, but I want to talk about it now because it's an idea that I'll bring up a lot. When he characterized stars by their brightness, he put them in groups. And this is basically a function of how the eye works. Your eye is very good at seeing things in, you know, daylight and seeing fast motion, and because your eyes are sort of designed for that. What your eye is not good at is seeing very far away things, very faint things. In fact, your eye has a very difficult time determining the difference in brightness between objects that are very faint. So when Hipparchus was making these observations, he was making these groups based on what he could discern with his eye. And he observed that stars appeared to fall into six categories. He called the brightest stars magnitude 1 stars. And then if you appeared fainter, you were magnitude 2, all the way down to magnitude 6, which is what the limit of the eye is. Okay. Now, effectively, this is a Rankine system. Okay, and so because of that, the numbers that are used are backwards in how you normally would think about quantities. A magnitude that is small, a small number, a 1 or a 2, is a bright object, whereas a magnitude like a 5 or a 6 is actually a faint object, which makes this system a bit difficult to work with because you're used to thinking like a big number is a big quantity. Well, this is the opposite, actually. Now, Hipparchus probably didn't realize this at the time, But the system is a reflection of the ability of the eye. And, you know, one way you can see this is if you think about being on a freeway at night or something, you see headlights and taillights. And for the most part, headlights and taillights don't look very different from each other. They all pretty much look the same, which you kind of want to have. But in reality, if you actually were to measure the amount of light out of a headlight or taillight, you would get different numbers for every single one. And it's because the eye is not really good at picking up differences and when things are faint and far away and it's dark. And it turns out that every magnitude difference between stars, it corresponds to a factor of about 2.5 in apparent brightness. Meaning, if I say that a star is magnitude 1 and a star is magnitude 2, the magnitude 1 star is brighter. And it's brighter by a factor of approximately 2.5 compared to the magnitude 2 star. This is an apparent brightness. This is how we see things. So we get approximately 2.5 times more light from the magnitude 1 star. So like I said, this is a system we still use today. It's been modernized. There's a standard that is used, and it's the star Vega. We call that magnitude 0. And magnitudes now can be 0, it can be negative. The actual numbers don't really mean anything. What matters is differences in magnitude. Individual numbers have absolutely no meaning at all. Everything is compared to Vega, which we call 0. There are bright stars. The brightest stars have negative numbers, actually. Planets that are very bright are negative numbers and so on. Okay. So let me ask some questions to see if you follow this idea here. The following is a list of stars and their apparent visual magnitudes. So you see these four stars here. Which of these stars would be the brightest as seen from the Earth? All right, the answer here would be A, Alpha Ophiuchi. Okay, it's the smallest apparent visual magnitude, therefore it's the brightest as seen from the Earth. Okay, just to be clear, we're describing apparent visual magnitude. Apparent is how things seem, how it appears to us, not how it actually is. We don't know how bright these stars actually are. Meaning if we line them up side by side, what would be brighter? We don't know because we don't know their distances. Later on in the class, we're going to develop a different idea where we will incorporate distances and we can arrange these numbers in terms of their true intrinsic brightness. For now, we're not doing that. And then visual just simply means what the eye can see. There are magnitudes at other wavelengths of light. We won't discuss those in this class, but some stars can look brighter or fainter in different wavelengths of light. All right, so Algarab, which is magnitude 3, how much brighter by intensity is it compared to Zeta Ceti, which is magnitude 4? So the answer here would be B. Every magnitude difference is a factor of 2.5. So Algarab is 2.5 times brighter than Zeta Ceti. Okay, that's the way you would say it. Now, this is a different question here. Slightly more complicated, but now we want to compare Alpha Ophiuchi, which is magnitude 2, to Situla, which is magnitude 5. So what would the intensity difference be there? Okay, so the answer here actually is C, 16 times brighter. So what I said here was that every magnitude difference is a factor of 2.5. Seeing that there is a three magnitude difference between Alpha Ophiuchi and Situla, we know Alpha Ophiuchi is brighter, and you need to multiply out 2.5. You need to have three factors of it. So for every magnitude difference, every one, there's a 2.5 number. So when you multiply 2.5 by 2.5 by 2.5, you get around 16. So we could say Alpha Ophiuchi is 16 times brighter than Situla. Okay, so we won't talk about magnitudes again for maybe another couple weeks, and it's very easy to forget this fact. Let me go back and describe it again. The Rankine system. Remember, small magnitudes, bright objects, okay? Large magnitudes, faint objects. Very easy to forget. It's a notorious thing people do in this class. I mentioned that the system is like modernized. It can extend to pretty much any number you can think of. The limit of the eye is around 6, and that would be with absolutely perfect conditions. Perfect eyesight, perfect conditions, like you're no light pollution, you're in an area that's pitch black dark, you can't see any sources of light. The brightest star in the night sky, aside obviously from the sun, is the star Sirius. It's negative 1.4. If you want to see anything fainter than 6, then you have to go and use a telescope. And telescopes can see beyond 6. In fact, there's a lot of things that are just not visible because of magnitude limit of 6. If you go to like a Hubble Space Telescope, that's one of the the most advanced telescopes we have in space, and it can see almost down to 30, actually. All right, so you can see that the sun's on here. It's negative 26.5 in magnitude, which seems ridiculous because the sun is, you know, insanely bright. But to give you a sense of how bright it is, you know, Sirius is negative 1.4, and your sun is negative 26.5. That's a magnitude difference of, you know, what, like 25 or so, right? So, you know, if you multiply out 2.5, you know, all those times, you get something like 9 billion or something like that. And the sun's 9 billion times brighter than the next brightest star in the sky. If you're curious, when it comes to observing things like in populated areas, like in Lancaster here in the Antelope Valley, you can't see that down to magnitude 6. Maybe you can see a magnitude 3 star, for example. Polaris, by the way, is like magnitude 1. Pretty easy to see. Magnitude 2 is not so hard. Magnitude 3 starts to push it. In very populated areas, it becomes very hard to see anything fainter than 3. So that limits you to about maybe 100 stars in the sky. So it's unfortunate, but there's not many places on Earth now where you can really see thousands of stars like you normally would be able to see without any light pollution at all. All right, so let's go back to the Greeks again. You know, the Greeks did hundreds of years of observations in the sky, and they had their original, what we call, geocentric model, Earth-centered model. And, but, you know, when you do this stuff for hundreds of years, some things start to stand out, and there are some very odd aspects of the sky that they really couldn't explain. Some things caused them to change the order of things, and some things that just had a very difficult time explaining. For example, sometimes the stars had very unpredictable motions. Stars, planets in particular, had what's called retrograde motion. And what that means is, as the planet moves in the sky, it appears to go backwards. And I'll show you an example of this right here. So in this video here, this is part of like the sky simulation software, very similar to the Stellarium program. What you can see here is, let me go back. Okay, so let me explain what you're looking at here. Imagine you took a picture of where Mars is in the sky every single day at a particular time at night, for example. And so you're piecing out all these pictures and you can create this animation. That's kind of what you're looking at here. So what happens is, if you were to watch Mars in the sky, you would see it, you know, go on in its normal prograde direction. It's moving to the east. But then occasionally what you'll notice is that Mars appears to slow down, and then it starts to go backwards in its orbit. And then it does that for a little while, and then it appears to slow down again, and then it continues to go prograde. And as you can see, the projection of this looks like this loop in the sky. And so we call these things retrograde loops. Now, the Greeks, you know, really had no idea what was going on with these retrograde loops. And so in order to put that into their models, they actually created these circles upon circles. And we call them epicycles. That's the name of them. And in fact, this picture you see here is attributed to Claudius Ptolemy, who is considered sort of the pinnacle of Greek astronomy. And this is the most developed geocentric system that the Greeks developed. In fact, the pinnacle of geocentrism we call Ptolemaic. That's the name of this model here. And, you know, this model, you know, it's not accurate, obviously, but it's not a bad model, actually. It has the epicycles in there to explain the retrograde loops. It actually has some subtleties that, you know, would be surprising here. Now, the moon is the closest to the Earth here. But you'll notice that Mercury and Venus have shifted in position. You know, before and back in Plato's time, Mercury and Venus were further out than the sun. And then they've changed it, and they put them so that they're closer to the Earth. And you might wonder, like, why did they do that? What could they see? Well, it all lies in understanding how to place the moon. You know, they put the moon in front of the sun, which may, you know, you may think, why would they do that, actually? Because, you know, the sun is the most prominent thing in the sky, and it's hot, you know? And you think that would be put up close, but, you know, the moon eclipses the sun. That was seen, and so obviously the moon has to be in front of the sun. Well, guess what? Mercury and Venus do that too. It's not often, but Mercury every few decades will eclipse the sun. And Venus can actually go hundreds of years between eclipses. And so you know, the Greeks really paid very close attention to the sky, and this model is a very good model, actually. While it's not accurate, they created these tables of data from this model, and astronomers had used these tables of data for over 1,000 years to predict where the planets would be in the sky. And so in that sense, it was a very good model, actually. After almost 1,500 years of using this model, there were problems, and they grew and grew and grew until they became very glaring problems, very difficult things to reconcile. And so there was a lot of revisions made to the system. They changed the way the epicycles worked. They added more epicycles. And this was the system that was used all throughout the scientific world up until the scientific revolution. So we jump all the way ahead to Nicholas Copernicus. And we credit with Nicholas Copernicus the development of the first heliocentric or sun-centered model. And why I say credit him is because he's the first person to actually have thought these ideas out and had a book published on this stuff. And his system is what is seen on the right-hand side. It's heliocentric, meaning it is sun-centered. And it is very similar to the Ptolemaic system, except for two things. Well, one, obviously, because it is heliocentric, you basically just switch the Earth and the Earth-Moon system and the Sun, and you get this system here. And this system has no epicycles. And that was the difference. And this was a good idea. In terms of being a model, it was terrible. It did not do a better job of predicting the position of the planets than the old Ptolemaic system did. But the reason why we're talking about this today is because it did do one thing very, very good. And while it wasn't a good model in terms of predicting data, the astronomers at the time realized that this is a step in the right direction. And it all lies in explaining retrograde motion. This model explains retrograde motion without the use of epicycles, which was the real great thing about this model. And really, to understand what retrograde motion is, you kind of have to think about maybe some examples. And if you have had this experience of being in a car, say in a parking lot, right? And say you're not paying attention to your surroundings, you're just sitting there fiddling with your phone or something like that, and the car next to you decides to back up. And you freak out for a minute because you think you're going forward, right? Because all you can see in your vision is just your car and the person next to you, and you can't immediately tell which one's moving. And that's relative motion. And it's a similar idea. It's like you're on the freeway and you're going, say 70 miles an hour, and there's a car in front of you and it's going 60 for some reason. It's going slower, and so you're going to catch up to it and pass it, right? And from the perspective of your car, you could argue it looks like the car goes backwards. Obviously, you know, because you can see the freeway, that you're both going forward, but because the car is going slower, it has the appearance of going backwards. And that's kind of what's going on here, actually. So this figure somewhat tries to demonstrate this idea. What happens in retrograde motion is when you let the Earth move, the Earth can catch up to and pass some of the other planets. And that catching up and passing gives the appearance of the retrograde motion, just like, passing a car on the freeway does. So the retrograde loop is just inherently explained by simply having the Earth move. You don't have to use epicycles. You don't have to have anything weird and external. It's just naturally in the model. And sort of the other scientists at the time sort of realized that this has to be the right answer. It's just such an elegant way to explain something that seems so difficult and strange. This model was not initially accepted, though, for a lot of reasons. I mean, a lot of people realized this was a step in the right direction, but there were some serious problems with the model. First and foremost being that it could not predict the position of the planets very well. And that's largely due to the fact that, he's still retaining circles in for the orbits of the planets, which is actually not how the orbits are. They're close, but it's really not that way. And there were some other problems. I mean, for example, this was developed before the notion of gravity was around. And so people look at this model and they see the moon is orbiting the Earth and they think, how is that? How can you do that? How can the moon orbit the Earth? Wouldn't it just fly away? I mean, there was no means to explain, how you would have the moon stay around the Earth that way. Also, those stars that are out there, if the Earth moves, you should be able to see what's known as a parallax, meaning as we go around the sun, you should see like a little wobbling back and forth that the stars do because, because of our motion about the sun. And we don't see that. That's not something you see with the naked eye. You don't see stars wobble back and forth. And there's two reasons why that would be. One reason is, well, you know, Earth doesn't move. So simple. That's why the stars don't wobble. The other reason is they do wobble, but the wobble is so tiny, it's so difficult to see because the stars are located tens of trillions of miles away. I mean, you know, what's easy to believe? It's kind of hard to try to get somebody to believe that stars are tens of trillions of miles away when the only distances you know of at this time are maybe 1,000 miles at best, maybe. So it's a very difficult thing to sort of believe. But like I said, a lot of people decided to give it their own shot. And in a later lecture, I'm not sure, maybe next week actually, I'm going to describe some of the other attempts that astronomers made to have a heliocentric model. Now, the last person I'll talk about in today's video is Galileo. And Galileo is a very important part of the development of the solar system model. And not only that, but he's also very important in the development of the modern way of scientific thinking. Galileo really represented a transition from a first principles-based science to an observation-based science. And, you know, the idea that, you know, you shouldn't have any assumptions in thinking about physical behavior or anything scientific, that you should always be able to test things and to determine how things actually are. He was famous for a lot of things. He was the first person to develop a telescope for the use of astronomy. In fact, he didn't invent the telescope. It was invented in, I believe, 1609 for navigation purposes. But when he heard about the design, he created his own and he used it to look at the sky. And what's amazing is that there's so many things in the sky that you just barely miss because you don't have a telescope. So he made a ton of discoveries. Some of his discoveries are listed here. He discovered that the moon has features that are geologically similar to the Earth. And that showed that, you know, the moon wasn't this celestial thing. It was actually very similar to the stuff that was on the Earth here. That was very important. He discovered that the Milky Way, which was this band of what appeared to be clouds in the sky, was actually lots of pinpoints of light. And that was the first notions of the fact that we live in a universe with lots of stars. And that eventually led to the idea of what galaxies are. He discovered that Jupiter has moons. And that's actually shown here. This is on the upper right is a portion of a journal that he kept in early January of 1610, where he observed that there were dots around Jupiter that moved every single night. And we call these now the Galilean moons. He discovered the four inner moons of Jupiter. And this was important because it demonstrated that, you know, you can have moons orbit another object. You can have other centers of motion. And people had problems with the moon orbiting the Earth and the Earth moves. Well, Jupiter moves in both systems and, you know, it has moons. So that was a very important discovery. He discovered that the sun had sunspots, which is believed to led him to get cataracts because he was looking at the sun without proper, you know, filters and things like that. So it was very damaging to his eyes. But, you know, if it's a good trade-off if somebody's going to talk about you, you know, hundreds of years later, you know, for your discoveries and just go blind from it. The most important discovery that Galileo had was based on a prediction. And so this is a really important part of the scientific thinking that he had. He looked at the models at the time, the heliocentric models. And, you know, based on these models, there are some obvious predictions you can make to show that one model is correct over the other. And that involves looking at Venus having phases, like the moon does. So you can see here, the picture on the left is the Ptolemaic system. And the Ptolemaic system's the prediction would be that Venus would always look like a crescent, because Venus would always be between the Earth and the Sun, and because of that, you would only see a crescent shape on it. Okay? Now, the Copernican system, where you let Earth orbit the Sun and let everything else orbit the Sun, has a very different prediction. You know, in a Copernican system, you can have crescents because, you know, Venus could still be between the Earth and the Sun. But if Venus is allowed to orbit the Sun, it can be on the other side of the Sun, which means you're going to have more complete phases. You can have half quarter phases, gibbouses, full Venuses, actually. And this is a pretty clear distinction. There's a real dichotomy between, you know, what these two systems had. And it was a prediction that he made that in it, with a telescope, you should be able to see Venus go through a set of phases like the moon does. And if you saw that, then that would really prove that that Venus orbits the sun here. Now, there's one little issue with that, though. You know, what else goes through phases? Well, the moon does. And what does the moon orbit? Well, the Earth. So just saying the Earth, Venus goes through phases is not totally complete. So we got to look at this question. This is going to finish off our video here. And this kind of gives you the other aspect. So according to the figure below, as Venus changes phases, would there be a noticeable difference in its angular diameter? How so? So think about this for a while. You may want to pause the video and really give this a good thought as to what the answer might be here. Okay. Now the answer here is D. Okay. Now let's actually go through all the options here and understand this. The first option is totally wrong. It says, no, the angular diameter would not change. Well, it does. It has to, right? You really learned about angular diameter in the last video. And what you learned was that angular diameter is a function of a couple things, one of which being distance. And you can see in the picture, Venus does change distance. It can get closer to the Earth or farther away. So it has to change angular diameter. The question becomes, is it noticeable, though? And that's what B is saying. Yeah, it does, but it's not noticeable. Well, how could we determine if it's noticeable or not? Well, if you remember from the first lecture, I mentioned that Venus was 0.7 AU away from the sun, Earth being 1 AU, right? So when Venus is in its crescent phases, it's close to the Earth. It could be as close as 0.3 AU away. Now, when Venus gets to the other side of the sun, you'd have to add up their distances, right? Earth to the sun is 1. Sun to Venus is 0.7. So you could, if Venus is on the other side of the sun, it could be as far away as 1.7 AU away. Those two numbers are pretty different from each other. 0.3 to 1.7, that's almost a factor of 6. You know, think about an object. Any object you look at, anything you can see right now, if you move that object 6 times closer to your face, are you going to notice that? Yes, you're going to notice that. That's a huge difference. So the difference is absolutely noticeable. In fact, it's true that the crescents of Venus are 6 times larger than the gibbouses of Venus. And that was really it. That's like the final nail in the coffin of the geocentric model. This definitively proves that that objects orbit the sun. Venus goes through phases, and it can be on the other side of the sun, or it can be on the same side as of the sun as the Earth. And there's a massive difference in its angular size. Okay, so that was it. That was the proof that we really lived in a heliocentric universe. Okay, so this rounds out the week 2 videos. And next week, we're going to be describing some more history, and we're going to get into Kepler's laws, right?